Hello again. This is James with the 7th episode of the FOXHOUND Rank video walkthrough. We pick up after the battle with the End and move toward Volgan's fortress, Groznyj Grad. Before we leave the forests for the mountains, we'll backtrack and use the ever-versatile Svatogorny East area as a testing ground for the mechanics of disarming guards with rotten food. We'll also take time to observe the lesser-known properties of snare traps and stamina drain. After heading up the ladder, we'll go through three mountain stages, each of which requires different strategies and skills to navigate quickly. To this end, we'll observe the different lengths of incapacitation time for guards who have been stunned, tranquilized, and choked unconscious. Once we've met up with Eva at the apex behind the mountain shed, we'll take a bird's eye view of Groznyj Grad, do a little recreational sniping, and then head back down into the fortress's maintenance tunnels. Finally, we'll review the boss design elements that MGS3 inherited from the overall Metal Gear Saga to create this video's concluding fight against the Fury. Let's pull up our last save file. You can beat the End a variety of ways, and I chose to tranquilize him after shaking him down for the moss camo. 1 hour and 25 minutes is a good place to be. If you defeated the End non-lethally, it's actually pretty easy to miss picking up his Mosin-Nagant tranquilizer rifle. The rifle spawns down and west of Snake's starting location, so be sure to go get it before proceeding. In most cases, you'll head for this area's northeast exit and climb the ladder to the mountain top. However, we're going to go south first here. I wouldn't recommend doing this on a FOXHOUND Rank playthrough, both because of the risk of getting caught and also the time drain. I'd like to review some general points about stamina drain and using rotten food to poke holes in patrol routes, and these are the best areas nearby to illustrate those points. Though now that I think about it, you might want to make a slight detour to this ammo shed in any case to stock up in preparation for the mountain levels ahead. The game usually keeps watch over which guns Snake uses most frequently, and it adjusts the types of ammo that appear in these sheds accordingly. So you should find exactly what you need. Let's turn our attention now to the moss camo. As we saw during the fight against the End, having the moss camo effectively solves the problem of hunger on a no-meal playthrough. The moss camo is finicky, though. The exact locations where Snake can stand and fill his hunger gauge don't match up perfectly with locations where he's standing in visible natural light. Taking the camo's name literally, any spot in the forest should fill stamina since moss thrives best in indirect sunlight and will actually fry in full sunlight. That is, of course, not the case here. In MGS3, though, your best spots to fill the hunger gauge with the moss camo are first, out in the open, without any trees, and second, under artificial lights. The camo refuses indirect sunlight, but lets Snake effectively eat incandescence and fluorescence. I can only conclude that this moss doesn't know what it is. Let's move on. A quick scan of the ammo shed reveals a few boxes of Mark 22 ammo, so it's time to stock up on empty magazines. I'd like to call attention to a detail that occurs when Snake reloads. The Mark 22 holds 8 rounds per magazine. When Snake goes through the reload animation, you'll see that he seats an extra shot in the chamber somehow. The 9th round appears over the edge of the 8th silhouette. It's not clear how that round gets into the gun. The most likely way would have been to change out the magazine when the last magazine's last round is still in the chamber. But Snake clearly doesn't do this. The conclusion to draw is that Snake is a wizard who can make bullets appear in his gun by desire alone. The infinite ammo, bandana, and face paint clearly augment some latent ability within his warrior soul to manifest the tools of war. Pulling a 9th round out of an 8-round magazine? That's why they call him Big Boss. Next, we'll take a look at an underutilized trap in Metal Gear Solid 3, the snare. Wear the cardboard box to run over the snare without getting caught. Interestingly, once caught in the snare trap, Snake will lose stamina at a much faster rate than normal. So let's measure it. The rate of stamina drain differs according to Snake's outfit. While wearing a uniform, it drains about as quickly here as when Snake is shot by the End. Thank you. 5 minutes and 42 seconds. Now let's see how long it takes to bring it down to zero without wearing a uniform. Notice it starts sooner. Minutes and 51 seconds, a little over half the time it took before. We won't use the naked camo often during this playthrough, but this is valuable information for planning Snake's escape from Groznyj Grad. One last thing just for fun. Place a claymore facing the snare, then before it becomes active, run over the claymore into the trap. Now free Snake with the knife, and he lands with a full shrapnel fanfare. Again, this is all for illustration purposes. The general knowledge obtained here will prove useful in the areas coming ahead. This is the last snare trap that Snake encounters in Metal Gear Solid 3, so if you choose to head south, just run past with a cardboard box. Now, if you chose not to obtain the M63 light machine gun during your approach to the end, you can head back now to grab it with your new Mosin Nagant. The level design in Svatogorny East is great for sniping, so the Nagant is perfect for handling the area on its own terms. Svatogorny East is much easier to approach from the north than from the south. This guard faces away from the north entrance long enough to allow Snake to don the cardboard box, minimize the drag created by any elevation bumps in the terrain, hook a sharp left past this stump, and make it into Svatogorny East without being detected. Now, we'll once more review rotten food. Both Groznyj Grad and the upcoming mountains can be very tough to sneak through. Enemy perception is high, and there's a lot more redundant guard placement than before. Rotten food can be one vital strategy for working through these areas ahead, particularly during Snake's jailbreak. That's why we're using the guards here as guinea pigs. It's basically a hidden way to play through much of the game, and the unorthodox approach makes it a personal favorite. Up on deck are three guards patrolling this tree-laden slope. Lesson 1. Hungry guards prioritize food over most other events. Here, the point guard forgets Snake in favor of the rotten hornet's nest. As well, the supporting guards forget their concern for the point man's injury in the presence of decayed mushrooms. Lesson 2. Guards will always eat if they're hungry. No matter how many times their friends get stomach cramps from bad food thrown at them from some anonymous beneficiary in the shadows, that 6-week-old bat wing still seems like a good idea. Lesson 3. When cramping, they don't care about footsteps, battle sounds, anything. They're as good as unconscious as long as you don't bump into them. Lesson 4. Throwing food briefly drops Snake's camo index. Notice how the guard ahead did not see Snake until I threw the item. Going back to Lesson 1, however, the fact that he saw Snake, thereby fulfilling his sole reason for patrolling this collapsing shack in a backwoods forest, pales in comparison for the chance to gorge on a rancid Taiwanese cobra. Lesson 5. A guard's first cramp will draw attention from any other guard within earshot. In the material world, sound is delayed and absorbed, if not outright stopped, by objects that intervene between the sound source and the hearer. This is not the case in Metal Gear Solid 3. Think of the first cramp as an event that triggers psychic awareness from guards within a set distance. Walls don't matter. When their buddies eat turned fish, they'll know. Again, go back to Lesson 1. Given the immediate need to check on a comrade doubled over from intestinal strife, the man of the hour chooses to consume a time-blighted coral snake. I have a feeling that the moral choice posed at the end of 1984 would have been a foregone conclusion if the Gru were involved. Now we need to build up to Lesson 6, so let's find the location of the final guard here for anyone who decided to return to Svatogorny East. The M63 will still be here, and I do recommend it for the Shagohod sequences later on. If you didn't get it the first time, and if you don't want to go back for it, though, don't worry. It will appear in the Groznyj Grad ammo shed, so you still have another chance to get it later on. Notice that I used the cardboard box to approach this porch. Running with the cardboard box can serve a similar function as crouch running did in MGS4. It lets you move while keeping your head down if you need to scoot underneath windowsills. Here I'm hitting the building's hotspots for item pickups, and you can, in fact, justify a trip back to Svatogorny East to stock up on supplies for the mountain levels ahead. The second mountain area contains ample provisions and ammo, but the best strategies require moving through that area without stopping to restock. If you're really low on ammo and other items after the fight with the end, popping in here can be a good idea. Svatogorny East has a relative abundance of suppressors for both the Mark 22 as well as the M1911. Unless you're trying for an all-CQC or other challenge playthrough, you'll want these on hand for several of the areas ahead, particularly Groznyj Grad. We're still waiting on Lesson 6, and we've cleared most of the ammo storage, so let's kill a little bit more time by playing with guard response priorities. In the previous video, I showed how you can negotiate this area entirely using the Payne's Hornet Stripe camo. This camo lets you hold on to swarms of hornets which will attack enemies within a given range, driving them off the map. Now, the sadism of commanding hornets to attack guards who are already stalled by stomach cramps might bring Snake down to Volgan's level, but let's take the moral low road anyway. It's an interesting peek behind the curtain of MGS3's guard priorities. When hornets sting a soldier, all other activities stop, and his flight response becomes top priority. Stomach cramps from having eaten rotten food occupy the same tier of priority. The result is a cycle between breaking the stomach cramp animation to flee and then becoming stationary once more. You can tell that the stomach cramp completely breaks the hornet flight priority because the hornets actually come back to Snake. Under almost any other circumstance, the hornets will chase the soldier completely out of the level. When a soldier no longer registers as existing within the bounds of the level, the bond between the guard and the hornets breaks, sending them back to Snake. Here, the stomach cramps also break that bond. It's a rare instance where two events of equal priority overlap regularly within a short space of time. One final item on this map is the adult book. These don't appear very often in European Extreme, so I tend not to use them. We'll grab this one just in case. Now we're ready to look at Lesson 6. Guard cramps are not eternal. They last about 5 minutes, after which the guard will stand up, return to where he was when he first saw the faded food item, and resume his patrol. These guys aren't done with this ride yet, so let's watch a bit until their tribulation passes. Here's a better angle. And there we go. This soldier is torn between the twin desires to learn some lesson from this mistake and, on the other hand, make a joke whose impact hinges on a pun that marries his occupation and the term GI. Note that he has walked back uphill. Again, remember that he'll always return to the spot on his patrol route where he was interrupted by food, thrown by Snake, or another guard's distress. I'd like to minimize my risk of getting caught on the way back out, and there's no sense in leaving without a little more torment to these AI wonders. As long as every other guard in this area is enduring his final throes of intestinal dismay, I'll circle back around to clear this line of guards out from behind. While I'm flanking their line, let's review the lessons about rotten food. 1. Hungry guards prioritize food over most other events. 2. Guards will always eat if they're hungry. 3. Cramps make them as good as unconscious. 4. Throwing food drops Snake's camo index. 5. The first cramp will draw attention from any guard in a given area. And 6. Guard cramps last about 5 minutes. I sincerely hope that the events in Svatogorny East today contribute to the creation of an urban legend that the woods are haunted by an invisible man who curses you with esophageal distress and then purges you with hornets. Good night. With our review of rotten food complete, we move onward to the mountain. Getting back through here is as easy as it was the first time if you stopped in before the end. The only guard between Snake and the Socrovano area starts with his back turned. This gives you ample time for a straight dash around this rotten stump and into the next area to the north. Now back on track, we want to switch to the moss camo. It helps with the stamina drain during the long ladder sequence ahead. We also want to restock on food. In general, meat goes bad more quickly than other food types, but mushrooms and fruit don't take very long to go bad themselves. The only food items that won't go bad at all are the hornet's nest filled with pain hornets, Russian rations, ramen noodles, and calorie mates. I recommend having a few of these on hand for upcoming guard dogs, since those dogs are smart enough not to eat food that's turned. With the pantry full, we can turn attention once more to the ammo shed. Backtracking to Svatogorny East resets the items that appear in this shed. As before, you can stock up on what's available, and you can also grind for extra magazines. You usually don't need any more than 9 magazines at any given spot to prepare you for the areas ahead. Once you get up to that point, it certainly doesn't hurt to gather more, but if you have the choice between a full inventory of ammo for your Mark 22 and just one more empty magazine, I recommend going with the full ammo stock. Suffice to say, it's probably not a good idea to actually empty an entire clip inside an ammo shed. Now it's time to say goodbye to Metal Gear Solid 3's first forested areas with a bang. Bang. And with that, we've closed the loop on our hypothetical detour back south. We've delayed progressing to the ladder in order to review some general information that will prove valuable at a later date, particularly during the first approach to Groznyj Grad and during Snake's post-torture escape. We looked at the novelty of MGS3's snare traps, and we use their unique feature of rapidly draining Snake's stamina to measure the different times for total stamina drain using a uniform on one hand and naked camo on the other. We return to Svatogorny East as a testing ground for general knowledge about rotten food strategies. Hungry guards will always eat, will prioritize food over everything else, will lose all senses while cramped, will more likely see Snake when he throws food, will hear other guards cramp within a given range, and will stay out of action for approximately 5 minutes. This information sets the stage for a valuable strategy during one of MGS3's more challenging sections, the naked escape from Groznyj Grad that strips Snake of both silenced weapons and, for some reason, CQC. We now take time to reflect on the magnanimity of the ladder, ladders past, and ladders fiercely to come. Thank you.
snake. If you want to go up or down a ladder, just press the action button by the ladder.
Amen. Moss Camo is great there because it photosynthesizes the artificial lights that Snake passes on his way up, minimizing overall stamina drain. Now, however, we're back to Tiger Stripe Camo. Because not everyone has acquired the Mosin-Nagant, I'm including sniping and non-sniping strategies through the upcoming areas. At the very least, keep equipped your cardboard box in Mark 22. This area is the Krasnogorzhia Mountain Base. That's base as in bottom, not as in headquarters. Metal Gear Solid 3 features a handful of points past which Snake cannot backtrack, and this is one of them. You can, in fact, run all the way back to where Snake fought the pain from the top of the ladder. After Snake slides down that little slope, your new backtrack point is fixed at Krasnogorzhia Mountain Base. It's the first of three mountainous areas whose terrains feature different grades of slopes to run up. In the base area here, the land peaks and troughs like ocean waves. The cardboard box is valuable for speeding up your movement through this area since the jog up those little peaks can compromise Snake's working through gaps in the patrol routes. Whereas forest levels were visually closed, mountain areas are visually open. Snake has fewer objects to hide behind, and he also risks being seen from guards posted at prospect points. We're going to visit the base area's prospect point right now to get a sense of where each guard patrols this level. What you see on screen now is not necessarily a strategy for moving through the base. I show this mainly to provide context for observing guard locations. The base's prospect point is immediately visible once Snake sets foot on the visually open part of this level. The guard here will slide down this incline to investigate if he sees Snake, so he is still a threat. The guard nearest Snake's entrance patrols near the bordering cliff. When his back is to the cliff, he will see Snake across the level. The second guard starts on the level's opposite end. This rock serves as a visual marker for his placement. Guard 3 patrols opposite the lookout point where we're at now. Guard 4 patrols the drop-off border with another boulder as a visual marker for his placement. And Guard 5 patrols the cliff border opposite him. This is what I meant when I said that the patrol routes become more redundant from here on out. The base has 6 guards that watch the interior of a visually open area, and each guard's line of sight overlaps the others. For our first strategy, knock out the first guard you encounter on the open plain. This will draw the attention of the lookout guard above. When that guard comes to investigate, have Snake lay on his stomach behind this ridge. Catch him from the side when he's no longer looking in Snake's direction. And then hug the walls with your cardboard box to avoid being spotted by the guards patrolling the opposite end. Use the troughs of each ridge to hide from the last two guards. When the cliffmost guard turns around, the drop-off guard will be watching his back. While this doubles up security, it also creates a blind spot that we want to take advantage of. If you're uncomfortable using CQC, here's how to move through here with guns. Shoot the lookout guard first. Just aim for the body and wait for the sedative to take effect. Then take out the nearby guard when his head comes into view from behind this ridge. Be aware that there are 2 poisonous snakes nearby. If they bite Snake, they can throw off your timing, and the injury counts against your Foxhound rank. Good night! Next, climb through this crawl space to reach the lookout point. we're going to try out our new-to-snake, Mosin Nagant. The Nagant has allowed a report than the Mark 22 and cannot be silenced. Guards will hear its shots. This is only a problem, though, if they can call for reinforcements. If Snake knocks them out when they start a call, the operator will still send reinforcements to check on him. Oh yeah, I forgot. It does take a little while to use the crawl space up here, so go ahead and refresh the tranquilizers on the two guards you've already taken out. Now back to what we were discussing. A chaff grenade will prevent guards from making calls out. Nearby guards, of course, remain aware of Snake's activities even if they can't call for reinforcements, but the resulting caution status is limited to only those guards who heard Snake's shots. Chaff grenades don't last long, so be ready to fire. The caution status will remain after the chaff grenade wears off, but it only remains as long as the guard who heard Snake is up and moving. Notice that the guard we just took out was patrolling as usual, and the caution status lifts as soon as we take out the only rankled guard over by the cliffside border. And now it's a straight sprint to the next area. As usual, the cardboard box keeps you moving smoothly over any terrain in your way. Our final strategy for the mountain base area is the quickest. As before, we'll stick to the perimeters. Don the cardboard box and run along the drop-off. Recall that Snake will fall to his death without grabbing the ledge if you cross that line while wearing the box. Be very careful. Hide behind this ridge until the guard turns to face the drop-off. Then take him out. Stick to the perimeter and hide behind this ridge until the next guard is looking away from Snake. And then take him out. Usually, one or both of the guards near the cliff will have seen Snake due to the cardboard box's low camo index. Keep moving and you'll have left before they arrive. Don't worry about this final guard. He's not looking, and neither is his partner near the cliff. We now approach the mountain side. We'll look at the first set of guards we need to deal with, and then we'll discuss this level's design generally. The first guard patrols two levels up from Snake's starting ground. His patrol route takes him from this spot, and we want to take advantage of his starting location. The second guard stands one level lower. You can see him just to the left of this rock. And there are two more guards higher up. A Hind helicopter circles around this level's cliffside border. It's not a threat as long as you're wearing the tiger stripe camo. The helicopter adds acoustic tension to Snake's movement through this level. The tension's important. This is one of the longest uninterrupted levels in the game due to the back and forth design of the mountain. This level is so long that any guards left unconscious behind Snake will become a liability if they wake up or get discovered by supporting units. Now, if you blew up the Hind at the Bolshaya Past base, this area will be covered with soldiers on flying platforms. We'll cover that strategy in a later video. The takeaway is that when you're playing through this area, don't worry about the helicopter, however nervous its volume and nearness might make you feel. It's a threat primarily on any difficulty except European Extreme, because it adds shells to the heavy artillery such as RPG-7s directed against Snake when he's caught. I probably don't need to say this, but for the sake of thoroughness, don't even think about attacking the copter. It'll enter alert at the slightest sign of aggression. First, let's play with the Nagant. Equip the Mosin Nagant and land a headshot without stepping forward. You'll get the caution mode counter, but it's only there because the first guard noticed that he'd been shot. If you step forward before firing, the Nagant's report will reach the second guard. For that guard, stand facing the cliff, enter first-person view, and hold the L2 and R2 shoulder buttons at the same time to stand on Snake's toes. Get a clean headshot, and then proceed. As always, remember your cardboard box. Next, we'll pull an old trick out of storage. Run ahead to catch the cliff guard's attention. Once he sees Snake, switch to a garish camo like the scientist outfit. Once he sees Snake at a negative 25 camo index, you'll see a new white exclamation point. As soon as you see this, change back to something that blends in better. He'll turn around and walk to Snake's position very slowly. We want to speed him up, so press against this wall and knock until you get three responses. Now he'll start running. Take care not to get stuck by this scorpion. Curing the poison counts as a serious injury. Guards in the mountains will treat the cardboard box as though it belongs there. You can actually wait in the box until he makes it to the bottom, and then knock him out. If you choose to go the non-gun route, my preference in fact, you want to drag this guard onto the nearby slope. Always grab the stun grenades in this hollow. Press against the wall near the second guard, and again knock three times to get him running. As he rounds the corner, he'll see the unconscious guard and investigate. If you recall from studying guard attention patterns, this leaves him open to attack. And again, you can proceed. We can save valuable seconds by cutting short the distance that the first guard runs. Let's review the first part of the strategy. Get his attention with a low camo index. Then change back to Tiger Stripe camo. Run to the cliff wall and knock until he responds three times. Now, however, run halfway up the slope and hide in the cardboard box. When Snake pops out, he'll pause between seeing Snake and going into alert. Use this chance to knock him out, and go through with the rest as before. Knock to call the second guard.
What's wrong?
And CQC him once he has passed. As noted before, timing matters on this level. We need some general knowledge, so let's see how long guards stay out from a normal CQC attack. Almost exactly 2 minutes. So what does this mean? Once you've CQC'd these guards, you need to be out of this level before that time is over. Otherwise, they'll wake up and call for reinforcements. That's gonna mess up your strategies ahead. Now let's see how long guards stay down when put to sleep. There's no time advantage in using tranquilizers, but there is an advantage nonetheless. Notice that the guard wakes up, stands in the direction he was already facing, yawns, shrugs off the nap, and returns to his post without incident. Keep that reaction in mind while we look at the downtime for a guard grabbed and choked until we see 6 stars. Tap the D-pad rapidly to do this. 5 minutes is a huge time advantage, but compare what's happening now to the wake-up response before. The guard stands up, automatically faces Snake's direction, calls for backup, and returns to his post with his gun drawn.
We're under fire. Enemy position unknown. Commencing alert status.
Stun KOs can come back to bite you, so use that time wisely. Now let's look at the patrol patterns of the next two guards. The highest guard watches over the final slope in this first part of the mountainside area. He's nothing to worry about. The other guard needs more attention. He's more likely to see you than the other one is. We're going to watch the patrol pattern cycle before moving on to strategies. It's important to have an intuitive sense of how long he's going to be in one spot or another. As you see, he leaves his post to walk down the winding slope to the left. If you're not sure how close he is to turning around, don't risk approaching him from behind. He stops at the base of the slope for his second position. He's more dangerous here than he is up above. From this spot, he can see most of the distance that Snake just covered to get where we're standing now. As you can see, he stays in this spot for quite some time. When you enter the mountainside level, he starts here and then moves up top. You should encounter him before he moves back down. Now, we need general knowledge regarding how backup units respond to guards that have been knocked out and tranquilized. As noted before, the guards left behind on this level can come back to haunt you. Here, we shoot one guard, and let the other one start a call for backup. Then we take him out. Now let's watch the entrance.
There's something wrong. Support unit, confirm their status.
As you see, follow-up units sweep the area behind Snake when the backup call is interrupted.
What's wrong?
Let's drop behind them and watch as they awaken a guard taken out by stun. They reach the first guard, and he awakens immediately. As we saw during the stun timer before, the awakened guard faces Snake. He then calls in backup.
HQ. This is HQ.
Now let's look at the response team.
Patrol here.
They remain attentive and move on to the next stunned soldier.
Commencing alert status.
That soldier wakes up, and he too is immediately attentive against Snake. And now we get to the most threatening part. The response team actively runs through the area, possibly looking for more downed sentries. If you're farther up the mountain, and if the response team performs a running sweep of the area, then you have extra pressure behind Snake to move forward quickly, compromising your ability to pace yourself and control the second half of this level. That RPG says these guys are getting serious about Snake. So that's what happens when the backup team finds stunned soldiers. Let's compare that with their responses when they find soldiers put to sleep. Once more, we put these guards to sleep. In the process, the second guard calls the backup unit.
There's something wrong. Support unit, confirm their status.
They run into the mountainside level. And now let's watch what's different. First, they do not go into caution mode after discovering the first guard. And the first guard doesn't turn to face Snake. Second, instead of pushing through the area, the backup unit actually pulls back. Putting guards to sleep before moving on can prevent getting caught in some scenarios. Those general tutorials show how to put down the second set of guards using the Mosin Nagant, a weapon that can summon a backup unit. If you've made it to this spot quickly, and if you're confident that this upcoming guard will not turn around to walk down the slope, you can use the cardboard box to catch him with CQC before he changes positions. Lure the next guard with three knocks on the cliff wall, then run to the farther side of the next slope. Catch him from behind. And now you can proceed to the second half of the mountainside area. That strategy depends on the first guard's position on the top level. Here's what to do if you're not confident that he'll stay in place long enough to catch. Knock three times against this cliff wall. And hide in your cardboard box beside the anti-aircraft gun. Knock him out when he's inspecting the wall. And proceed as before. This removes his body as a distraction for the next guard. Once you knock to call the next guard away from his post,
what's that sound?
Put the cardboard box in his path. When he stops to look at the box, pop out and take him down. Sometimes, especially when using tranquilizers, that first guard will see Snake approach. Listen for his verbal cues. If he sees Snake, take off the box immediately and hug the cliff wall. Then shoot him with the Mark 22. Letting that guard see Snake adds an uncontrolled element to this strategy, so I recommend being proactive. He'll still be on the lower level if you're moving quickly, so turn to face his position once you reach this large rock. He'll stand there for a while, so you have plenty of time to line up a headshot. As before, this removes that guard's body as a distraction for the guard coming up. To keep moving quickly, we can use the time delay effect of the tranquilizer darts to our advantage. As always, we knock three times to draw the second guard away from his post. Once he turns his back, instead of using CQC, we can auto-aim and hit him in the back with a sleep dart. If we're using guns, then we want to take the high road for better positioning, and we want to use the box to speed up Snake's progress. Listen carefully, and you'll hear the second guard drop from the chemical's time release. We're ready to look at the final guards in this area. Their vision is less interrupted by elevation changes than the guards before, so maintain a low camo index as you approach. That means unequipping the cardboard box as you round the corner. As before, you might encounter these guards in different positions when you approach. This is the most widely roaming guard. He'll start on the hill in front of the shack to the left, walk down both slopes, walk toward the lower path, and stop with his watch across this area. He'll be here for a long time. For the sake of speed, you need to be here before he takes up this spot. Our second concern as Snake approaches this area is the guard in front of the food shed ahead. His pattern is simpler, and he's less of a threat to Snake on first approach because he simply changes his view from front to back. Coordinating his moves with the first guards is tricky. If you're going to distract the second guard with a low camo index, you need to do so before the bottom guard gets nearby. Snake will be seen by the bottom guard even with a high camo index on the top level. Distracting these guards with the low camo index can be ideal if you've arrived at the right time. Both guards need to be all the way toward the back so they don't go into alert. We just saw that the bottom guard will see Snake with a high camo index even if he's standing at the bottom. Now let's change into a low camo uniform like the scientist coat to illustrate how conservative you need to be with your decisions here. You'll note that the bottom guard is only at the floor of the last slope. This is close enough to trigger an alert. Now let's look at what does work. The left guard needs to be all the way at the back. Even when Snake's camo index is high, he'll perceive Snake with a white exclamation point. Wait until both guards are looking at Snake. Then immediately switch to the scientist coat. New white exclamation points will confirm that they're coming to investigate. Now switch back to the tiger stripe camo. If you've done this right, the guards will follow the exact same path, one behind the other, all the way around to the bottom path, onto the rock shelves that Snake climbed onto the upper path, and all the way up the upper path until they reach where they saw Snake. That means that, once they clear the bottom of this ledge, you are free to proceed without concern. You even have time to duck into this side shed and grab the RPG-7. You'll need this for the Shagohod fight ahead, but don't worry about grabbing it now if you're short on time. It will appear magically in your inventory when you need it. The third final guard is behind this shed. You can always approach from this direction and he will never see you. A nuance about guard attention emerges in this scenario. Once guards see Snake from a distance, they will train their sight on that spot until either Snake moves with the same camo index to a different location, or until the terrain breaks their line of sight. Let's watch this in action. They're on their way. Notice that their heads face straight forward as they descend this slope. Now that they're at the bottom and the terrain no longer conflicts with their line of sight, they're actually approaching while looking up at the exact spot where they saw Snake. This is somewhat exploitable here. First, we'll draw in the guards. Notice that if Snake stands in this spot long enough, the first guard who notices him will come to investigate independent of the camo change that lures in the other guard. When they start on their way, the terrain breaks their body orientation from Snake. This is your chance to roll forward to advance just a bit sooner. The downside here is that you'll still need to wait until they've completed their circuit down both slopes and under the overhang before you can proceed safely. Here's another interesting thing. A guard's attention will log the most recent location where he saw Snake. In this instance, Snake flipped down at a camo index low enough for one of these guards to continue tracking his movement, and at a camo index high enough to avoid triggering a full alert. Therefore, the guard stops at the bottom of the cliff to look for Snake. The second guard, however, who did not see Snake flip, continues along his path. Here's an easier scenario to play with this in. The guards will keep their bodies oriented away from Snake in concert for a longer period of time on the second slope. When their heads both face away, flip down and take your place behind this rock. Here's an even better angle to observe the upward tilt of their heads. And then we move onward. Note once more that the third guard's patterns don't matter here in the slightest. Walk around the shed, take him out, and move on. Next, we'll look at guns and blowing up the food shed. We run into the same troubles here with the Mosin Nagant's report as before. The difference is that, when the backup unit enters the level, they'll enter all the way back at the start. We're close enough to the end that we're in no danger that they'll press us from behind. This is where our earlier lessons come into play. If the backup units find the guards asleep behind Snake, then they'll wake them up and leave immediately with no ensuing caution status. If, however, the backup unit finds stunned guards, they'll go into caution and press forward. If you're not interested in blowing up the food shed, the sleep option is not a problem. If you are, however, bear in mind that even the first guard in the level will hear the TNT explode. Once that TNT explodes, you're right back into caution, which makes the next area unnecessarily hard. I'll show you how to avoid that. Before drawing either guard away from his post, have chaff grenades ready from your backpack. If you don't have chaff grenades, use one of the methods here other than the Nagant. Throw the grenade, then ready your gun so you can shoot the guard as soon as the grenade goes off. They can't call for backup, and caution mode is effectively blocked. And now head to the level's end. It's important to snipe from the location shown here in the video. Any closer and the last guard will hear the gun report and go into caution. You want him following his normal patrol route when you arrive. If you're going to blow up the food shed, be certain that none of the guards are sleeping nearby. You don't want to accidentally kill one. Most often, you'll want to remove the guard shot directly in front of the food shed, and you don't need to take him far. Here is a safe arrangement of guards if you've chosen the chaff grenade and Nagant strategy. As a side note, Metal Gear Solid 3 is curiously liberal with its distribution of medical items. It wants you to involve yourself with Snake's physical maintenance more than it wants you to feel the tension of dealing with a slow-healing injury. Now we're finally ready to put all these pieces together. Our goal is to make it to the end of the level before the first knocked-out guard wakes up. This will enable Snake to blow up the food shed without going into caution mode. First, we'll use lures and CQC. Call down the guard with the scientist camo. Run to the base of this cliff, and get his attention with knocks 3 times to get him running. Then place the cardboard box in his path. We're about to choke him out using 6 stars, so we'll have 5 minutes to get from here to the food shed. And our timer begins. Knock on this wall to call the second guard. and choke him out. Use the cardboard box to eliminate any drag on Snake's speed caused by the terrain. We're here before this guard heads to the lower level so we can choke him out straight off. Now we lure down the final guard.
What's that sound?
And choke him out when he observes his knocked out comrade. We'll take the low road this time. I won't often diverge from explained strategies during a sample run-through, but this takes advantage of enough of the skills that we've observed generally to be intelligible. The nearest guard's sight is turned away because the terrain orients his body away from Snake. So just wait and choke him out. Grab the upper guard's attention so that he'll investigate, and he'll see his knocked out comrade.
What's wrong?
You can take him out from behind. We're around the 2 minute mark, which means that we still have 3 minutes to spare before the first guard in the level awakens and goes into caution. And now to blow up the food shed. From our first attack to the final explosion, we've taken 2 minutes and 20 seconds. Next, we'll measure the timing on a tranquilizer run through. Shoot the first guard straight off. We have a shorter time frame than before, and Snake starts a little further back when the timer starts, so we need to move quickly for this to work. Stand on Snake's toes near the cliff for the second guard, and turn around at this boulder to pick off the third guard before he sees Snake run uphill. Knock 3 times to lure down the fourth guard.
What's that sound?
Then shoot and dash to let the chemical take effect. We're sniping, so we need to take the high road. Good night, sweet prince. We sing your lullabies in Valhalla. Next, we need chaff grenades. We'll stop the timer here since the guard is effectively paused while we're in Survival Viewer. Throw the grenade. Take out the fifth guard. And then take out the sixth. Knock out the seventh, and drag the sixth food shed guard out of harm's way. If you've moved through here quickly enough, you'll detonate the food shed almost exactly when the first guard goes through his wake-up animations, during which he will not perceive the TNT explosion. With all that under our belts, we're off on our next adventure. The mountaintop is a lower maintenance area than the mountainside. Here are the first guards to deal with. First, we have a lookout positioned near the anti-aircraft guns. Second, there's a guard who patrols the ground level. Third, there's a guard in this trench. I'll provide a variety of strategies here to accommodate different factors such as available weapons, ammunition, and food shed status. We'll start using rotten food. You only need 5 rotten food items for this level, but it doesn't hurt to equip more. There are several points where you might need to throw a second item to compensate for a bad first throw. We want to call down that lookout, so run onto the snow to drop Snake's camo index while the lookout's watching. Throw food to the ground level guard, then throw food to the guard in the trench. Immediately throw a second food item into the trench. If you recall from our rotten food tutorial before, cramps prevent guards from eating additional food. As well, hungry guards will overlook their comrades' injuries in their hurry to eat. The lookout walks down through the trench, and he's taken care of as soon as he sees the second food item. The highest lookout guard is one of the 2 guards that we'll focus on next. In general, he stays around the oil drum and the anti-aircraft turret. Proceed through the trench so he won't see Snake, and take care not to bump into either guard. A straight dash up the trench is thwarted by another sentry past this intersection. He's the other guard that we'll deal with next. For now, take note of his position in the level. The best way to land food in front of him is to bounce it off the wall. Use the crocodile cap to improve your aim. Next, throw another food item beside the oil drum. The guard will hear it land and come running. There's a lot of incidental noise from the helicopter here, so you can use the directional microphone to confirm that he's taken the bait and suffer the consequences even if he's out of sight. We're almost done here, so throw on your cardboard box and keep moving up the trench. If you've moved through here at a good pace, the final guard will be patrolling away from Snake, showing you his back. Just roll into him. He's hungry, so the roll will knock him out for only 1 minute, but you'll be out of here by the time he wakes up. We'll take a look once more to see each guard's location. And then we're off to meet Eva in the mountaintop shack. Remember that the helicopter is as little a threat here as it was on the mountainside. For the next strategy, let's assume that you did not blow up the food shed and that you do not have the Nagant, but you do have sleep ammo. First, pick off the nearby lookout. Then the ground level guard. Then the guard in the trench. By now, the second trench guard has seen the sleeping lookout you shot before. As soon as he climbs up beside the gun, take him out. I use the Nagant here mainly to improve visibility for tutorial purposes. You can take care of this guy from the trench, but this is the best angle to illustrate where he'll appear. Handling the final guard takes more skill than usual. When you reach these 2 sleeping guards, climb out of the trench. Run onto this slope until you see the trench guard's white exclamation point. Aim carefully, and hit him with a headshot before he comes to investigate. Before moving on this time, let's take a look at the ammo shed. Its holdings will depend on the guns you've been using, and you can use this opportunity to stock up on empty magazines. There's no need to blow this up, however, since destroying the ammo shed mainly affects the guard's decisions while chasing Snake, a luxury you don't have on European Extreme. You might need those magazines for walking back down the mountain. Again, we'll survey the locations of the guards that we've taken out, and we move on as before. The strategy changes a bit if you're using the Nagant, for good and bad. For good, it's easier to line up an accurate shot, but for bad, the report volume forces you to handle the guards differently. First, as before, take out the nearby lookout. The ground and trench guards alone will hear the shot and go into caution mode. Take out the trench guard first. Now shoot the second trench guard above. Don't worry about accuracy for the ground level guard once he changes patterns. Just shoot him and wait for the sedative to take effect. This gives you plenty of time to take out the highest lookout. Finally, wait for the ground level guard to keel over before pressing ahead. You might have noticed that backup did not come when we interrupted the first trench guard's call for help. The mountaintop is an exception to the rule we examined on the mountainside. Had we let him finish his call, Snake would have been pressured by backup units from behind, but this gives us time to keep control of the space ahead. Here's a second way to deal with that final trench guard. Run up to the corner before his line of sight, go into first-person view, and peek out. He will not see Snake lean out, so headshot him and proceed. As always, meditate on that Swiss Army knife of Metal Gear Solid, the cardboard box, as you head up to meet Eva. For our final strategy, we'll assume that you don't have any ammo for the Mark 22, you don't have a Nagant, and you did not blow up the food shed. This leaves CQC. Run onto the snow patch and draw the lookout's attention, and then take out the ground level guard. Jump into the trench and take out the guard there. Drag his body downhill past the gap in the wall. Leave it there and wait for the lookout guard to arrive and investigate.
What's wrong?
Now take down the lookout. Use empty magazines to turn around the second trench guard. You might need to stand on Snake's toes in first-person view and try a few times before you succeed. This is a closed space, and he sometimes blocks the magazines you're throwing. The third trench guard has his back to Snake's ascent, so he's easily handled. Finally, throw an empty magazine at the cliff wall to turn the last guard around. This gets us through in under 2 minutes. So we're out of here before anyone wakes up to call for backup. Once you've met Eva, this is a great place to save. If you've had trouble with any particular area covered so far, you might consider saving there as well. After the cutscenes, we're overlooking Groznyj Grad behind the mountain shack. It's a detailed miniature model of the area coming up. Here we see the Shagohod hangar, and here we see the torture facility. We can see each area where Snake and Eva visit during their bike chase escape from Groznyj Grad. From the hangar, they move through these storage bunkers, and then weave between these tanks, finally escaping beneath this elevated hallway. After an area load sequence, they go around the back of the hangar and work through Gru soldiers around these tents and auxiliary buildings. Finally, they make it onto the Shagohod's runway. Now, they're flat here in this smaller model, but you can see the structures that Snake and Eva passed during the last leg of their escape from Groznyj Grad. You can also see some of the elements that the developers of the Metal Gear Solid 4 Metal Gear Online tweaked to make Groznyj Grad a playable level. These upper walks were made accessible to provide multiple ways of getting around enemies, and the scientist lab where Snake captures Rykov was developed into a landing spot for players who use the launchers installed within the level. Watchtowers were exaggerated for sniping, the space around the torture room was developed into a team spawn area, and they took out many of these ancillary elements to balance the threat of open space with the opportunity to take cover. Here's a little-known trick about this view. Very tiny soldiers patrol Groznyj Grad in the distance. You can actually snipe them from this location. You're far enough away that they will not hear the Nagant's report. And if you want to play with them, don't worry about headshots. Just put the needle anywhere and wait until they drop. Snake, on the other hand, can hear them fall just fine. Knock, knock. Who's there? Oh god, you've been shot! What a terrible joke. If you're going to mess with them, be sure to save your game beforehand. They might not hear you, but if you miss, they'll go straight into alert. These guards have strange intuition. So here's how you take care of the two littlest guards. Shoot one. Then the other. Wait for one to drop. And then the other. I have no idea what good this does, but it's neat anyway. Now head back down through the shack. Past these noodles to Snake's left, you can see Eva's discarded boots under the chair. Punch this spider and make Albert Schweitzer cry. Here's your final chance to prepare for Groznyj Grad. Check out the ammo available on the ground floor. Remove weapons from your backpack that take that ammo. And as always, empty your ammo magazines to stock up for distractions. Don't forget that the AK-47 will give you 2 empty magazines per ammo box. Now we're ready to descend down the mountain to the Groznyj Grad maintenance tunnel. Fire troopers have arrived since Snake first ran through. You'll discover one on the path parallel to where you exit the shack. Throw an empty magazine into the other trench. This will turn that fire trooper around. Be careful about attacking him, though. The distant guard will not see Snake because of a high camo index, but he will see the fire trooper go down. Once the fire trooper goes down, he'll go into caution mode. Caution mode here will thwart the most effective way to get to your destination. Two additional fire troopers and one backup unit will arrive at the level's south entrance. They sweep the area through the trenches, and this puts more eyes on the maintenance tunnel door. That's not a good situation. These fire troopers are thematically appropriate and fit the game's presentation of each boss. Snake encounters hornets in both nests and cutscenes during the Ocelot fight as prelude to the pain. He also encounters an area full of traps once before encountering the fear. He moves through some of the densest forest leading up to the end, and here we encounter throwaway fire troopers patrolling corridors right before the fury, an enhanced fire trooper who pursues Snake through several corridors. So the practical takeaway is don't attack the fire trooper. Distract him with one magazine, then throw a second further down the corridor to put him further off schedule. Next, slide into this little nook. We're going to note the positions of the next guards we'll deal with. First, another fire trooper patrols this trench. Second, a standard GRU oversees a catwalk near the ammo shed. He'll turn to patrol toward the maintenance tunnel door, putting his eyes in Snake's direction. After a short wait, the second fire trooper will begin patrolling away from the door. Once he starts moving, he's effectively of no more concern. Let's look at a full strategy using empty magazines. First, you want to distract the nearby fire trooper.
Huh? I hear something.
And again? Huh? Climb up near the mounted gun and slide into this snowy patch. Wait for the trench guard to turn around. Then, when the catwalk guard turns towards Snake, throw another magazine on the ground behind him. When he turns around, this is your chance to slide down and dash for the door. If you blew up the food shed earlier, the troops here will still be hungry, and you can use the rotten food strategy. Throw food at this angled wall to ricochet it in front of the fire trooper. He'll eat it and reap his gut rewards. Now again, climb up and slide down. The trench guard will have turned around by now, so throw another rotten food item at the catwalk guard. Once he cramps, drop down and then proceed. Roll and box your way down these stairs. Once you reach the bottom, you'll find some ammo at this dead end. Groznyj Grad begins just after the fight against the Fury, so take this last chance to prepare for the series of guards you'll encounter there. As well, pull out the weapons you'll need to beat the Fury non-lethally. These include the Mosin Nagant, the Mark 22, and stun grenades. To get more food, land a stun grenade underneath these bats. The flash will overwhelm their bat's senses, causing them to fall dead. Now turn right at this intersection and shoot these explosive barrels. Behind there, you'll find Mark 22 ammo and a battery. The battery lets you use night vision goggles longer during the fight against the Fury. I'm going to use the moss camo near this fluorescent light to recharge Snake's stamina. While we wait, I'll illustrate how Metal Gear's boss fights emerge from recombinations of elements found previously in the series. The Fury's fight takes place in a level reminiscent of the Machine Gun Kids from Metal Gear 1. Snake hid from a hail of bullets down long corridors, attacking the boss from the side with remote-controlled missiles. The same corridor design appears during the Fury's level, as seen here. MGS1 applied the character design concept to Vulcan Raven, another heavy machine gun soldier who Snake had to attack from the sides with remote-controlled missiles. Likewise, the Fury cannot be attacked head-on while he's attacking too. He has the weapon of the Fire Trooper from Metal Gear 1, and MGS3 further connects him to Raven via cutscenes. Both Solid Snake and Naked Snake shield their faces from an intense elemental blast, one ice and the other fire, before facing down a powerful enemy with a two-handed weapon and an ammo pack on his back. Most Metal Gear bosses can be dissected this way. They're recombinations of old design elements, and they achieve the effect of being both novel and familiar at the same time. For the fight against the Fury, I recommend going in with black camo and face paint. It helps you take him by surprise. Once you flip down and skip the cutscenes, I recommend saving. You might want to practice this fight a bit before clearing and heading into the fortress. The Fury's opening move is somewhat unpredictable. He'll fly over Snake and land somewhere on the platform behind your starting position. If you only have the Mark 22, you'll need to hunt him to attack him from behind. This spot here is usually a safe starting position. The Fury will walk along any of the corridors except the one where Snake starts. Sometimes he'll also patrol the drop-off at the end. Listen for his heavy footsteps as a clue to his location. This early in the fight, he hasn't shot much napalm around the area. If you see flames down one of the corridors, it's a good sign that he's nearby. The Mosin Nagant is hands down the best weapon for taking him out quickly. The time it takes to cycle a new round ready to fire is precious in this fight. Be sure that your scope can target the Fury without much adjustment up or down, and use the tactical reload to fire three shots rapidly. As we see here, getting hit by the Fury can have three results. First, there's the immediate damage. Second, Snake sustains a serious burn. Third, Snake remains on fire, which continues to drain his life. toggle the cardboard box on and off to put out the flames. Snake will die in only 2 hits during this fight. Let's look at another combination of opening moves. I'm using the Nagant here, but this strategy is best suited for Mark 22 usage, since you need to be close with that gun. We see the Fury emerge from one of the corridors, and he does not look to the right as he passes Snake. This is the second ideal situation to catch him by surprise, when he shows you his side. If you connect 3 hits in a row near the drop-off, he'll fly over the edge. During the time he takes to fly back to your level, hide. His speed and attack rhythm both increase the more damage he sustains. If he's still moving slowly and if you're safely on the opposite end of the corridors, run lateral to the openings and watch for him. This usually gets you through the first half of the fight. Be secure in the knowledge that unless you have a dangerously low camo index, he will not see Snake if he's more than half a corridor away. Remember, his speed gets better, but his perception does not. This next point is very important. If you have to adjust the crosshairs up and down, that adjustment disappears when you use tactical reload. Make sure that your aim is on the Fury's level before you attack using the rifle. This is one of the hardest parts of the Fury's attack patterns to accommodate. He will use his boosters to charge through a corridor, then he'll fly over one side of the level. During this, he'll spray napalm everywhere. Do not try to attack him here. He's hard to hit, and his attack hits you wherever you hide.
Where are you hiding?
Here's what it looks like when you use the Nagant on a level different from the Fury's. Notice that I have to adjust the crosshairs down every time I fire. This is not always fast enough to chain 3 attacks against the Fury. I recommend avoiding the risk if possible. Again, if you're here, he'll hit you. As you've seen, the Fury can be difficult to track. When you're on the southern end of the level, you can make finding him easier if you switch to the traditional pre-subsistence camera. This way, you can peek all the way down corridors without actually exposing Snake to detection. You can also use the drop-off ledge to Snake's advantage. This is why recharging stamina before the fight is a good idea. If you see the Fury coming and don't think that you can get away fast enough, drop off the edge and hang down. Oftentimes, the Fury will walk right by without noticing. And if you come across him in close quarters, roll to knock him down and give yourself some room. If the Fury shoots his flamethrower while Snake's hanging over the edge, it will not hit Snake. If, however, some of it sticks to the drop-off wall, Snake will catch on fire in a hanging position. If you're low on health, this is a death sentence. You'll usually burn to death before the climbing animation finishes. If you're not low on health, though, you've still got time to act. And, of course, be careful when using the cardboard box near ledges. If you go over, Snake's dead. That is one of the best performances of that set of words. Now let's look at one of the most important characteristics of the cardboard box during this fight. The box not only puts out fires, it will never catch on fire. The godlike qualities of the box continue to mount. In addition, when running, you'll get a slight camo index boost. When you're running to hide, especially midway through the fight when everything is on fire, keep the cardboard box on.
Where are you hiding?
I could, in fact, watch this all day. I mean, it's just... it keeps happening! Well, up to a certain point, anyway. Notice that Snake catches on fire when hit by the Fury's flames. If he's wearing the box, he will not catch on fire after that first hit. Here, in fact, it means the difference between life and death. Let's observe that in a more controlled situation. We bait the Fury into attacking, and we leave the box off. Snake gets hit, catches fire, and the flames consume his health. While wearing the box, however, he merely sustains damage from that first impact. This can be vital if you're low on health. You can attack the Fury with stun grenades, but these are useful earlier in the fight than later. The Fury needs to be very close to the grenade to take stamina damage. Accurate aiming depends upon his slow pace. As well, after you've thrown the grenade, he'll turn towards Snake no matter where the grenade exploded. Here, for instance, the grenade blows up in front of the Fury, yet he turns around to attack Snake. Stun grenades can also be useful if thrown through these horizontal gaps that connect the corridors while the Fury's running down a different hallway. Intersections and right angles are also great places to hit him with grenades. Snake's hearing will diminish after an explosion, which takes away one of your best means for locating the Fury later in the fight. Be mindful of that lost sense. Always use tactical reload when attacking with the Mark 22. The Fury will return fire during the time it takes to cycle another round, and Snake will be completely vulnerable. Keeping your sights on the Fury can be difficult when you're peeking in first-person view around a corner with the Nagant. If you find yourself in this situation, don't worry about tactical reload. Get close to the wall, then simply return to cover after quickly popping out. Snake will hold the gun close to prevent collision with the wall, and this has the same effect as tactical reload. Sometimes, before making a flying round of the level, the Fury will verbalize a countdown. If you have an idea where he is when this begins, run there immediately. He will not attack Snake during this countdown, and he is completely vulnerable. Just be sure to land that third shot. Here's what that corner pop-out trick with a Nagant looks like one more time for reference. A while back, we picked up some night vision goggles. These amplify traced light sources in an environment, which seems like a good idea in a very dark area. However, when the Fury plasters the wall with fire, this can overwhelm your vision. I prefer not to use these during this boss fight. Here's a comparison of what night vision looks like compared with regular vision. If you think this works better for you, go for it. I prefer to start the fight by sniping at the Fury using infrared goggles. As with the night vision goggles, fire creates sensory overload after the Fury has attacked a few times. These are great for locating him over an unblemished distance. As you see here, he stands out in the corridor when otherwise the black of his suit would blend into the shadows. There's no fixed way that a fight with the Fury will happen. I'll therefore show you several successful boss fights against the Fury, with new and old observations along the way. Here, I start by sniping the Fury with a Nagant over a distance. Stamina-wise, the fight is nearly half over. I want to point out the ceiling heights here. Notice that the edge corridors have low ceilings, while the central corridors have high ceilings. When the Fury begins a high-altitude torching of the level, duck into these side corridors. Here, he will not hit you from above. Only do this, though, if he's in the middle of a high-altitude attack. He can still blitz straight through low corridors if he's low to the ground. When the Fury walks out of a corridor, this is a great chance to hit him from the side. And now, of course, hide. He seems like he'll run towards Snake, so I'll take a chance with a grenade. And it pays off. I can hide behind this column as he attacks. And now it's a game of watch and wait. He telegraphs his blast-off maneuver, so I can hit him with a Mark 22 using tactical reload to end the fight. This time, I'll run toward where he lands. Note the cardboard box. He sees me, so I take refuge behind this column. The Fury has disappeared, so I use the box to run through these flames while keeping my ears open for his footsteps. Right now, I have no idea where he is. We found each other, and he'll surely attack, so I run away. I know he's on the other side of the level. Until I hear his footsteps or his blast-off telegraph, I assume he's still over there. I act upon this assumption by watching each corridor. Found him. He'll probably charge forward in his current corridor, so I run down a nearby corridor to possibly catch him from behind if he's slow. Now I'm camping in one corner. If I see or hear his flames emerge from one of the hallways, I know I need to move. Otherwise, I can watch the end of this hall in case he emerges. Here's a key point. Like Vulcan Raven, he moves faster as the fight progresses. Snake should therefore stay in one spot to catch him as he moves past. Reacting to sound, I watch the Fury emerge from a hallway on the other end of the level. Rather than pop out and attack, I wait to see where he's heading. Right now, he's telegraphing a short flight burst,
you can't run away from me.
So I race to catch him before he flies off. I didn't get him at the start, but I hit him as soon as he lands. It's too hard to get a follow-up shot here, so I take cover. Once I see him nearby, I always keep some small piece of terrain between us. I can see him, but he cannot see me. And I wait for him to make himself vulnerable. And now it's time to run away. Preferably to a corner where I can watch the level's extremes. Toward the end of the fight, he will sometimes patrol the landing where Snake first entered this level. If you're well hidden, he is ripe for the picking. Later in the fight, you might need to move between corridors to take cover. Use the start of the fight as your opportunity to shoot these barrels. This will give you more room to maneuver later. And here's the ideal opening move. I run to one of the corners of the level to watch where he goes. The flames indicate where he's coming from. He flies out of that corridor. And I am well enough hidden to take him by surprise once more. This last bit of stamina is often the hardest to wear down. I wasn't wearing my box, so Snake takes burn damage. These holes between corridors become most useful during the latter part of this fight. If you hide against this wall, the flames will usually miss Snake, and the Fury will find you less often. It's a great spot to take your chances and then catch him from behind. Here's our last run-through. Clear out the barrels. Now equip the thermal goggles. And make your opening move. Then run toward the opposite end of the level. I use the traditional camera here to keep an eye on his location. I want to try hanging to catch him as he walks past. Of course, this involves watching and waiting. Notice that he sprays fire at Snake's general direction. This does not mean that he actually knows where Snake is. On European Extreme, the Fury's AI gets luckier as it sprays at random. Don't let it psych you out.
Where'd you go?
I'm almost out of grip strength, so I take a risk. And it succeeds. To retreat, I simply hang back off the ledge. Then I move elsewhere in the level once the Fury has moved on. As before, the remainder of this fight takes place not on the extremes of the level, but in the middle. I need to catch him as he's moving through the corridors, so I frequent these nooks, sometimes unsuccessfully. More watching, more waiting. Finally, though, I catch him as he telegraphs his flight. And I use tactical reload with the Negant to end the battle. And that brings us to our stopping point. If you've beaten the Fury on European Extreme, congratulations. Next time, we'll infiltrate Volgan's fortress, Groznyj Grad. Until then, take care.